Okay, I'm Milan Mrkcic, and really delighted as director for the new Center for Synthetic Biology to welcome everybody here for our launch day, our official opening. And it's also good to see so many friends and colleagues and students in the room to join us. I'd like to take about 10 or 12 minutes and give a background, how we got to the point of launching a center, why is now the right time and Northwestern in the right place, and then you'll hear from the deans and Jay Walsh, and then we've got two special lectures today, one from our own Mike Jewett and one from Jim Collins, head of our advisory board at MIT. And so let me start with describing what synthetic biology is, because there are different definitions and not everybody in the room has been following this field. It's really about using biology's approaches, biology's methods to make molecules that biology might not really need to make and hasn't made before, but whose machinery is well suited to make it. So in two bullet points, we say that it's about the design and construction of new parts, devices, and systems. And by parts, you might think about amino acids. We're built out of proteins. We have tens of thousands of proteins that make us up, but they're all built from the same 20 amino acids. But as synthetic biologists, we can invent 21st and 22nd and additional amino acids that can give proteins brand new properties and functions, and that's an exciting opportunity. We also think of cells as laboratories, doing experiments in cells, both to learn better how cells operate, how they're designed, how they can be modified for new functions, but also to create cells that might serve purposes that, again, we don't think of as biological. That image on the right shows cells on a microelectrode array, and in fact, it's possible now to build micro devices that are both living and non-living. Have cells as living components that provide functions like sensing, and then have the inorganic part of the device there for computation and data reduction. So these possibilities hinge on the special designs and capabilities of what biology produces, but takes them in a direction that's quite different, and in the extreme, in a direction where one loses the view of the biology. And this, of course, has a big opportunity to change the way that we develop and practice medicine, to change our technology tool set and what's possible in the engineering world, and to impact society. And in that point, this really represents what many people see as the ultimate deliverable of synthetic biology, new ways of producing useful molecules and materials. On the left is clearly a factory where we today find polymers or fuels being produced. On the bottom left is a more specialized production facility for microelectronics. But on the right is a field of an agricultural field, and on the bottom there, a vat that can be used to culture bacteria. And if we learn how to take biology's principles and parts, reagents, we might be able to move from a world that's largely centered on the left of that slide to one that does things really returning to where we were before the Industrial Revolution on the right side. And there are already a couple of really exciting proofs that this is possible. Artemisinin is a molecule that's currently used to treat malaria. Hundreds of millions of cases each year, many of those outside the developed world. And this is a drug that's currently isolated from plants. And so it's made by a plant. Plants have to be grown, collected, processed to produce relatively low yields of this molecule. And a pretty substantial effort has been successful in moving that biosynthetic machinery into yeast, which is obviously much more easy to culture, produces molecules, much higher yields, and is now actually a commercial process and is producing much of this drug that's used. It wasn't an easy task. Here we say 150 person years of development was required. That's a conservative number. And a lot of this was in fact funded by the Gates Foundation, which is quite excited about new technologies that can extend and help the third world. Well, this is a first example, the Model T of cars, if you like. And the future is one that we're excited about as we learn to more efficiently engineer biology and really get a lot more successes under our belts and develop this field. And so at Northwestern, how did we get to the point of creating a new center? Well, it really started with a core group of faculty that were cheerleaders and successful cheerleaders in this area. And these were five folks you'll see in a moment who were recruited into McCormick as young faculty and kind of organically assembled into a community that was excited about synthetic biology. And that happened while there was a broader interest growing on campus in all the schools of faculty and students who were likewise excited about what could be done with biological engineering. At the same time, different universities across the country and the globe have been creating organizations to promote research in this area. MIT, one of the leaders, we've got Jim Collins here today, and we'll see a beautiful example of what's happened there, but it's still very much the early days. There are no departments of synthetic biology. There are a handful of centers, and it's a great time to create a community here at Northwestern. It's also important to provide the shared resources, the infrastructure, the specialized equipment that we need, and that can't be done at the level of a single group. And it's also happening because of a strong commitment and support and partnership by the administration, starting with President Shapiro, Provost Linzer. We'll hear from the Vice President of Research, Jay Walsh, in a moment, and the deans of three schools, Julio Atino in McCormick, Eric Nielsen in the medical school, Feinberg, and Adrian Randolph in Weinberg. And this is, to me, really remarkable, that this has been a perfect intersection of a ground-up, grassroots interest in an area, meeting an incredibly supportive and enthusiastic administration from the highest levels that wanted to give support to this area and see it happen. And I think, Jim, as we talk to you, you really, I think, have been impressed with how quickly we've been able to really get this going at Northwestern and how much support we've had on campus to do that. And our goal here is to build a community which is a top community, second to none, for students, for faculty, for visitors, for the public, to engage with synthetic biology and make this one of a very few destinations in this field. Okay, here's the group of young people. I like to say that because I'm the oldest. And Mike Jewett, as co-director, and I have really taken the lead in putting this center together. But Josh Leonard and Netta Bagheri and Keith Tayo, also who've been at McCormick now for at least a few years, have been key partners here. Lori Zoloth is an ethicist, and you'll see in a moment how we've included that in the center. Then I want to say that Julius Lux and Danielle Tolman-Ursik are not here yet. They've committed to coming to Northwestern. They'll arrive this summer. Julius is here. What I want to point out is that already the center is creating an intellectual environment and home that's helping us recruit really exciting faculty from other institutions. Julius from Cornell and Danielle from UC Berkeley. And it's exciting to see so quickly the center having a broader impact in the university, and one that I'm sure is going to continue even now as we talk to candidates. And Julius, I just have to say, this is the first time he's been on campus for a formal event, and he's got a purple tie on. And the reason that I like that is that before I moved to Northwestern 4 or 5 years ago, I didn't own a single piece of purple clothing. I probably ran from it, and now half my closet's purple. So good luck. Okay, now one thing that we did, Mike and I, is we actually traveled across the country and visited what were and what are the leading centers to learn how synthetic biology was being kind of set up on different campuses, what worked, what didn't work. And in the course of that, we also recruited a dream team of scientific advisors to our advisory board. And that includes Jim Collins, who's here today. Jim is regarded by many, including myself, as one of the real fathers and innovators, entrepreneurs in the field. And so we're thrilled he could take time to come join us today. Jim's a MacArthur awardee and also a member of all three professional academies. Francis Arnold at Caltech, likewise, a real figure in this field from the start, widely respected, and does a lot of service. And for her to agree to also take some time and work with us, I think was, for us, really special, and a statement of her enthusiasm for what we were doing. And Frances, likewise, has a long list of distinctions, also including election to all three academies. And Wendell Lim at the University of California, San Francisco, is a real expert in really combining cell biology in a very traditional sense with engineering pathways in cells. So he represents, I would say, the cutting edge of bringing synthetic biology to biomedical problems and with a translational focus. And that's an important part of our center. So to have Wendell as part of our advisory board is special for us as well. Okay, the center is organized with four research themes. The first is cell-free synthesis, the idea that you don't actually engineer the cell to produce molecules of interest. You can take the parts in the cell that are relevant, pull them out, and create a reaction system. Our own Mike Jewett has been the pioneer in this area, and we'll hear from Mike about that theme in a moment. Mammalian systems. The field is largely focused on bacteria and plants as the biological backbone. And we're moving into mammalian systems, which are both more challenging, but offer a lot more opportunity for building molecules with richer structures. And Josh Leonard is one of the early leaders in that area, and we're excited about developing a presence there. Enabling technologies. As we really learn how to engineer biology, we want to bring the high throughput technologies that let us do it massively more rapidly. And our lab is one that's been developing those tools, and that's going to be a theme. And then ethics and societal impact. Synthetic biology can raise a lot of concerns in the community. And we think some of those are legitimate concerns that should be addressed with scientifically sophisticated inputs. And so we'd like to have that as part of the center, where we're part of the dialogue, considering what the pros and cons and ultimate benefits are and how they should be managed. Okay, the website launched today. It's an amazing website, I have to say. I don't want to sound like Don Trump up here, but it's a really fantastic website, and I won't say it's going to make Northwestern great again, but I do want to thank Kyle Delaney and Emily Ashford and Krista Battaglia for all of the work in putting it together, getting the logos and organizing it. And I encourage you to visit it. We'll also have a presence in education, and I think impacting a lot more folks on campus. Okay, is that my time? Mike, did you set the time? Okay, good. So there's a number of courses that have been started over the past couple of years, more to come. We support the iGEM competition. This is every year a competition with a self-assembled team of undergraduates. It's a national competition, and they create a project with faculty supervision to engineer microorganisms or other systems that have really exotic functions. And we've had great teams out of Northwestern place really well. Lower left, we've had outreach events. This one was had to do with ethics and religion in synthetic biology, attracted a lot of participation in the community, and we're excited to keep engaging the community in that way. And then our students self-assembled a journal club. And by that I mean they came to us with a well-developed plan, and all they needed was a check, which we were happy to write. They meet every couple months, and they organize it, they lead it, and they cover topics from science to policy to industry, and it's been really exciting to see them now have a home as well. Okay, so I'm going to wrap up here, and I've got to thank a few people. First, I've got to thank the administration, as I said, from the president, provost, VPR, the three deans, the many chairs who've gone out of their way to help us get this going, both financially, as partners, and helping with recruitment. I want to thank Margaret McDonald and Ellen Feldman in the Office of Research for really helping us get organized and making this a real center on campus. Amy Polkras, who's really done the logistics for today and the reception at 5. Two special people who work with us daily, Yael Meyer and Dalush, who really are the only ones who know everything that goes on. And I think that's it. So with that, I'm going to ask Julio to come up and make a few comments.
Yeah, my name is Julio Tino. I'm the Dean of Engineering in McCormick. So I'll tell you from my side my involvement in this. So I was born and bred in nonlinear dynamics, chaos. Was chair of chemical and biological engineering, where most of the people now at the center are so far. And then I had a lapse of about 2 years, or maybe less, to think. And then I created something that was the Institute, or the NICO, which is the Northwestern Institute for Complex Systems. As to how that happened, I'll tell you this because there is probably a lesson on how to create things within a university setting. There's something in here. Northwestern believes in its DNA that cross-linking is good. And one result of that belief was something called domain dinners. Domain dinners was created by a committee, and I take credit for part of that idea, this domain dinners idea. So domain dinners were subjects that would nucleate faculty from across campus and create communities that will sort of live on. We did a couple. The first was in material science and chemistry. That was in 2000. That was interdisciplinary, okay? Chemistry and material science and maybe some biology. No one bats an eye for that now, okay? It's common. And then we had a vacuum and we didn't have anybody proposing ideas. So I came up with one and was who on campus had an interest, regardless of the discipline, in issues having to do with complexity, complex systems. And that's the idea that eventually gave birth to NICO. From day one, I wanted biology to be part of NICO. Okay? And what I was thinking in terms of biology was mostly something that at the distance will look like the supply network created the Dreamliner, which in the level of complexity, if you look far away, was like a metabolic pathway in a cell, something like that. So I wanted biology because of that picture. And I was thinking mostly in terms of systems. But eventually, my Jewett was hired, and then Josh Leonard, and then I thought we had something good in there, and then Keith came and Neda came, and then I pushed more for that. And eventually, you have one more person, two more persons, and you have, then Milan showed up, but actually before Neda, I don't remember the timing, but finally, it was the realization that we had something big in here. And somewhere in that line, I told Mike and Josh, we have to create a center out of this. And this is where we are now. But the center should be spanning all parts of the university. When we had a conversation with Eric, he came on board, and I'm really delighted to see this becoming a reality today. Thank you.
Thank you, Julio. And as Julio said, this is a center that will span the entire university. And it was really exciting when the Dean of Feinberg Medical School, Eric Nielsen, met with us a year, even a little bit more ago, and was equally enthusiastic about synthetic biology and how it could offer new opportunities in the medical school and also connections to Evanston. And Eric has been a real supporter in many ways, including creating new faculty positions that could bring additional synthetic biologists in who are anchored in the medical school and really focus on biomedical translation is their goal. So, Eric, thanks again for all your support and for being here with us today.
Thank you, Milan, and it's really delightful to be up here on such a lovely day. This is an exciting moment for both the Chicago and the Evanston campus. We have a long history of thinking about how to bring discovery to the bedside down at the Chicago campus and the medical school. I mean, if you think about it, and may not realize this today because we take so much for granted, but just about everything we do to a patient or at the bedside or in the clinic started as an experiment somewhere. And the experiments have been quite interesting, and the therapeutics and diagnostics that have come out of them have been truly astonishing. But there is, in my mind, the next generation of therapeutics and diagnostics. And they may take on forms that we don't recognize through the normal genetic code. We may need to change that. We may need to develop systems that allow us to create new materials that re-engineer what would otherwise be a natural biologic system. And it opens the door to a great deal of creativity and opportunity. And this is an exciting thing to explore across the campus, and something that all of us are very excited about. Part of the center is going to be down in the new research building, and there'll be an opportunity for a lot of shared collaboration with what is a giant growing down in the Chicago campus as it begins its long interest in creating new ideas to improve human health beyond the individual patient. So I welcome the start of this, and Milan, thank you very much for having me up here today.
Thank you, Eric. And Jay, can we have you come up? Jay Walsh is the Vice President for Research, and together with Dan Linzer, our Provost, have also been instrumental in helping us get going, providing us with resources, with advice and direction. Jay's been behind the start of a number of centers on campus, and I can tell you personally, his mentoring and guidance here have been critical for us. So thanks for also being with us.
Thank you, Milan. Kind words. So I'm a bioengineer by training. About 35 years ago, when I was about the age of maybe some of you, and not others, I had an interesting discussion with my undergraduate advisor, and I said I wanted to go into bioengineering, and he said, that's not engineering, because biology is descriptive, and there are no fundamental principles, unlike physics and chemistry and mathematics, which are the foundations of sort of traditional engineering, which he was. So after a few minutes of arguing that point, I realized I wasn't going to make any headway. And thought I needed a different advisor. Maybe you've felt that in your life at some point. Things have changed in the last 35 years. And 30 years after having that discussion, right here, almost exactly 30 years ago, we had a symposium called Biology by Design. And Mike and Josh were really fundamental in putting that together. And there were luminaries who were brought to that. Wendell Lim, and this Jim Collins guy. So, you know, they were revolutionary in this sense. And this is the story, a sort of continuation of what Julio said about how things happen at this university and how they should happen in academia. They start with a small seed. They're watered. This was some of the water and fertilizer. And then they grow. And now, you know, in the last year, we've brought in Julius, who's apparently already here in purple, and Danielle, who I actually had an opportunity to visit out in out at Berkeley. It's not dissimilar from other stories that we have. There was a Center for International Comparative Studies, I'll keep this short, that started many years ago. And it got a little bit of water internally, so we funded it internally. And then Bertie Buffett came along and gave a little more money. And then Bertie Buffett came along, and after watching the impact of her fertilization of the Center for International Comparative Studies, gave her monumental gift, which now brings us to the Buffett Institute, which will grow that institute from a center that's largely focused in the social sciences and humanities to something that will span across the entire university and look at international studies broadly in engineering, in law, in medicine. So this is the vision that we have for centers, is they start small. They start with two assistant professors who put on that symposium 5 years ago. And they lead to the launch of a center now. And I can only imagine where this will grow, because biology has come a long way from being a descriptive science. And these folks in this room will drive this forward. So thank you.
Hey, thank you, Jay. So now we get to the science, what actually drives this field and what it's about, what makes us excited. Let me just thank quickly a couple of other folks who came down. Rex Chisholm from the Feinberg Dean's Office, Kelly Mayo from the Weinberg Dean's Office. We also have international participation today, the Consul General from Serbia, Mr. Dan Radulovic. Thank you for joining us. Okay, I'm going to invite Mike up now, and Mike's going to give a lecture. Mike is known to all of us here. He's been at Northwestern about 6 years, did his PhD work at Stanford, postdoctoral work in Denmark, and then with George Church at Harvard Medical School, and came to Northwestern and from the start was changing the world. Mike is a real champion and pioneer of the cell-free biosynthetic approaches, which we'll hear about today, but also done really critical work in really redesigning, re-engineering the ribosome to give it more capability in making proteins. He's been well recognized, an NIH Pathway to Independence Award when he started. He's a Packard Fellow, a Dreyfus Teacher Scholar, a DARPA Young Investigator, along with a long list of additional really impressive accomplishments. So, Mike, I want to thank you for all the work that you've done as my partner in getting this going, and look forward to working with you in this.
Thanks, Milan. Super. Yeah, it's been just a tremendous honor equally to work with you, so thank you for that. And in fact, I'll come to some comments, at least thank yous, towards the end of my talk, but at least for now, I do want to dive a little bit into some of the science that we've been doing in my lab to really think about how one might be able to repurpose biological systems for novel manufacturing paradigms. And before I get started, I just want to thank the people that really make this happen. So in addition, of course, to the tremendous support that we've had for the administration, I have the wonderful job of being able to work with some of the most fantastic and talented graduate students. So Jim and I were talking about this earlier today. As an advisor, you're always looking to work with talent. And I just am thrilled to be able to work on a daily basis with my group and thank them tremendously for that. The work I'm going to talk about today has been mainly the product of a particular graduate student who Jim is looking for a postdoc, Eric Carlson, and it's been funded mainly by the David and Lucille Packard Foundation. So I think about biology as a technology, and what motivates me about biological systems is that they can do things that no other man-made technology or chemistry can do, right? So biological systems can use a very simple set of fundamental building blocks and new near-universal genetic code to work across length scales, from the molecular level to the macroscopic level, as you're seeing here in this plant growing. It can replicate itself from a single cell to millions to billions in hours, right? That's incredible. And in addition, it can evolve and adapt complex function to realize objective functions that we actually aren't able to understand in some ways as engineers. When I think about this, I'd like to be able to imagine a world where we could harness biological systems and leverage these amazing foundational abilities of biological systems to manufacture any product renewably, quickly, and on demand. So how can we, as scientists and engineers, leverage our ability to program living systems, leverage our ability to re-engineer the genetic code even, to manufacture things like materials, new types of medicines, solutions to global health, such as my colleague Keith Tayo pushes and is driving in new paradigms. And in fact, indeed, advances in our ability to read, write, and edit DNA are reshaping our ability as a society to be able to do this. So they're reshaping not only the biotechnology industry, but also driving economic growth at a global scale. And just as a statistic, for example, in 2002, bio-based production in the United States represented about 2.2% of the US GDP and accounted for about $353 billion in economic activity, with annual growth continuing to grow and accelerate. And as I look at the future, what I imagine is just as we sit in the electronic and information age, and my three-year-old understands how to use my cell phone, and how we once were in an era of railroad and steam transforming society, that our ability to engineer biology, our ability to engineer biological systems as a modular substrate will transform society in the next 50 years, next 100 years. And in fact, that's why I'm so excited about this center catalyzing, I think, new opportunities and new directions, not only within McCormick, but in particular is driving new opportunities in translational medicine with Feinberg. The challenge, of course, is I'd like to be able to engineer biological systems to do something. But being able to engineer microorganisms, in particular for manufacturing, remains costly and slow. And so just as one example, the ability to produce 1,3-propanediol, which is a monomer that is produced in an E. coli cell, a normal gut microbe, that can be polymerized into a long chain that acts as a material, took about 15 years to market and 575 person years of time. So for me, that's about 120 PhD students. And this is a challenge. So if you look at other classic examples now that synthetic biology raises up as true demonstrations of technology, we still have issues with our ability to rapidly move through design, build, and test iterations and apply engineering fundamentals to accelerate our ability to engineer organisms for biomanufacturing products. And so that begs the question, why is engineering biological systems so slow? Right? And so there are many reasons, and I'm going to highlight a few that my lab likes to think about. So first of all of these chemical reactions that we might be interested to, let's say, produce a small molecule or produce a material, take place behind a selective barrier. So, and indeed, that barrier is the cell wall, and that limits sample acquisition, monitoring, and direct control, which we've learned through other engineering disciplines can be dramatically transformative to our ability to control catalytic ensembles. Cells are also adapted to a relatively simple chemical operating system. So what I mean by this is most biological systems use a few sugars, a few amino acids, and a few nucleotides. But beyond that ultimately is it. They, of course, arrange these in many different orders, but this presents researchers and synthetic biologists like myself with a limited set of accessible molecules with which to work. And finally, one of the challenges that we focus on a lot in my group is the fact that it's very difficult to balance intracellular fluxes inside of microorganisms to optimally satisfy active synthetic pathways to manufacture molecules while the cell's trying to stay alive. So put another way, engineering living organisms is hampered by our ability to try to manage both cellular and user-defined objectives. Cells have adaptation and growth objectives that really are diametrically opposed to the idea that I can convince a yeast cell to manufacture insulin at high titers. Right? The yeast cell doesn't care to make insulin. And so how can we deal with and address these challenges? And in fact, I think this motivates more broadly many new tools to understand, harness, and expand the powerful capabilities of these biological systems. And indeed, many researchers within not only our center here at Northwestern, but more broadly in the synthetic biology community are addressing and developing such tools. In my group, we're developing strategies that we believe will widen the traditional model in biochemical engineering, mainly in two directions. So in one direction, what we're thinking about is how can we seek to repurpose the translation apparatus for synthetic biology. I'm going to spend actually all of my time today talking about this story. But in addition, we seek to create actually a new paradigm for engineering catalytic systems without having to be constrained by living systems. So in fact, without being constrained by the fact that the cell would like to maintain its viability. And in fact, I know Jim is going to highlight a couple of interesting and innovative new applications that a variety of researchers are pushing into now in this space. So let me talk about a story that we published last year in Engineering Ribosomes. So we like to think about this as creating new cooks in life's kitchen. So the ribosome is a large macromolecular machine. It's 2.5 megadaltons. It's shown here with a large 50S subunit and a small 30S subunit below. What it does is it reads the genetic code in a template form, which is shown here in this stretch. It's known as messenger RNA. And guided by the information in that messenger RNA, it catalyzes the polymerization of two monomer units. And in fact, it continues to polymerize monomer units that are delivered to this active site into this long stretch of an amino acid-based polymer, which we know is a protein. Now, the thing that fascinates me about the ribosome is that it's amazingly fast, right? So protein elongation rates, the rate and process that you're watching happens in bacteria about 20 amino acids per second, so 20 hertz. So the flicker rate in your eyes is about 40 hertz. Old movie reels are about 23 frames per second. So this is the active catalysis reaction going on, not the sampling rate. So just to put that in perspective, which of course must be much faster. It's also very accurate. It makes these polymers with an accuracy of 99.99%, which from a chemical perspective, the idea that one could produce a templated polymer with 99.99% accuracy of hundreds of monomers is transformative. It also permits diversity and allows for genetic encodability, which is something we'd like to ultimately leverage for being able to evolve new types of materials. So one of the questions that my ribosome team thinks about very frequently is, what if we could make designer ribosomes? So let me take a step back for those of you that might be non-biological experts. So we think about the ribosome as the chef of translation. So you have here information that's stored in a cookbook, such as that of Julia Child. There's a machine inside of the cell known as the polymerase, which transcribes this information into a temporary copy of RNA. This temporary copy is then translated by our favorite chef into whatever meal or protein that you might want. Okay? Now, we all know that the chef determines what we can make, and some of us were blessed with fantastic parents that really knew how to cook. Others may be less so, you never know. But you know that Julia Child might cook such a cuisine, but there are other cooks that specialize in different types of cuisines. And so one of the questions that we'd like to think about is, what if we could create ribosomes, new types of chefs that can actually polymerize different types of molecules? We actually believe that there is a possibility to begin engineering ribosomes, these macromolecular complexes, to enable templated polymerization of abiological polymers. So the idea is that we would like to understand the constraints of an RNA-based active site in a polymerization reaction driven by an information template. So we think that there are opportunities not only in engineering ribosomes or these chefs of biological cells to produce new polymers, but also to boot up virtual machines inside of living organisms. The idea that one might be able to have two parallel operating systems, just as, for example, the Mac users might have two operating systems that can drive multiple genetic programs, we would like to imagine doing this in cells. Of course, the issue comes back to this tug of war that I tried to suggest a few moments ago, and that is that the requirement of cell viability constrains mutations that can be made to the ribosome. So this macromolecular machine maintains growth and reproduction of the cell. And in fact, the ribosome must decode every messenger RNA in the cell to synthesize its proteome. And what I just mentioned is an idea that I would like to be able to leverage a ribosome to not only study new function, but create new function, create virtual machines, change the catalytic active site to enable polymerization of new types of chemistries. And that is, in fact, opposed to what the cell would like to do. So in fact, we're imagining the cell as Mrs. McGrady, who is a chef with many skills that can produce all of the proteins of the cell, yet we need something that might be highly specialized for whatever our engineering objective function may be. And so one of the goals of this team is to develop enabling technologies for engineering ribosomes, and we do this in test tubes because that decouples us from the genetic architecture of the cell and the evolutionary baggage that might come along with it, but also to be able to boot up in a parallel operating system format the idea that we have two ribosomes, one population of ribosomes that is maintaining cell viability and keeping the cell alive, and another population of ribosomes that's carrying out some user-defined objective. And so, in fact, in the efforts to build ribosomes in test tubes, what we've been trying to pursue is the ability to break ribosomes into their molecular components and build them. And there's growing interest to do so for a variety of reasons, not only understanding ribosome biogenesis, which is a very important process, booting up minimal cells, but also constructing engineered variants, as I motivated a minute ago, so creating new chefs. The ribosome, again, as I mentioned, is this 2.5 megadalton molecular machine that's comprised of two subunits. You have the small subunit, which is shown in teal here, which is comprised of 21 ribosomal proteins and a ribosomal RNA. You have the large ribosomal subunit, which is shown here in gray, which is comprised of 33 proteins and two RNA pieces. So in fact, you have this macromolecular complex that's made of 57 molecular components, and we'd like to understand how to build that in a test tube. I'm not going to talk about those results today, though. So in fact, to keep us streamlined and on time, I just would like to talk about a simple story, perhaps not so simple, about trying to engineer ribosomes in living cells. And this has mainly been driven by an adventurous graduate student in my lab, Eric Carlson, a postdoc named Cedric Aurier, who now has his own permanent position in France, and my dear collaborator, Shira Mencken, who's down at the University of Illinois, Chicago. And our idea was we would like to create a ribosome in a cell that allows us to decouple an engineering objective from that of the cell. So the concept is we'll keep a population of ribosomes that allows the cell to live, and we'll have a population of ribosomes that can be evolved, changed, and even direct different types of genetic programs in an orthogonal manner. Now, this is hard. And this is hard because, in fact, the cell leverages a bipartite machine in the ribosome, this large subunit and small subunit, to enable protein polymerization. And so previous researchers have leveraged the idea that the small subunit of the ribosome reads a sequence on a messenger RNA known as Shine-Delgarno sequence. And that allows for a specific specificity to enable direction of the 30S subunit to the RNA sequence and ultimately enable protein synthesis. Researchers, in particular driven by Hui and DeBeer in an early paper in 1987, and then more recently by Jason Chin, who's at the MRC, were able to create a population of small subunits of the ribosome that had an inverted Shine-Delgarno anti-Shine-Delgarno sequence. So this sequence that allows for specific recognition of the small ribosomal subunit to the information that it's trying to read. And what that allowed is for a population of small subunits that read a specific population of mRNA which did not cross-react with the ribosome that were keeping the cell alive by synthesizing its natural proteome. Now, the problem is that the random exchange of ribosomal subunits that occurs naturally during recurrent acts of translation presented an obstacle for engineering ribosomes. The idea that the large subunit of the ribosome, because of the way translation initiates, can talk with either of these subunits means that you don't have a fully orthogonal system. And so we set out to try to create such a fully orthogonal system. And so how would one do this? So our possible and our key idea when we got started was, well, we'll try to link the large subunit to the small subunit. So if you imagine creating an umbilical cord, for example, between these two subunits, that allows them to not break apart, and now you have a fully orthogonal system. And that's because the specificity of mRNA selection is dictated by the small subunit ribosomal RNA. You could enable this orthogonality of a full ribosome by doing so. The challenge, of course, here is that the bipartite nature of the ribosome is one of the key paradigms of molecular biology. So the fact is, ribosomes in all kingdoms of life exist in two subunits. And I'm saying, well, we'll just stick them together. And that was our goal. Now, if you wanted to do this, how could you imagine going about it? And so our idea was to imagine creating a chimeric ribosomal RNA. So I mentioned the large ribosomal subunit has this long 23S ribosomal RNA. And the small ribosomal subunit has this large ribosomal RNA piece known as the 16S. And we wanted to create a single piece of RNA that somehow connected the two. Now, the other option is, of course, trying to engineer knob and hole or key-like scenarios across the interface. But this is a 6,000 square angstrom interface that's mainly made up of RNA. And we didn't know how to predict de novo how to make the right RNA folds and keep the ribosome active. So if we wanted to create this chimeric structure, we needed to make sure that it properly interacted with ribosomal proteins and biogenesis. So this long ribosomal RNA piece would still have to assemble with the 54 proteins of the ribosome. This linker had to be long enough to provide for the ribosome to go through its initiation, elongation, and peptide release components. However, the linker could not be short enough to ensure that there's no crosstalk with freely exchangeable ribosomes. So for example, you wouldn't want this small subunit to be able to talk to a regular 50S subunit. And the linker should not be cleaved by RNases. So this led to a key challenge. So in fact, we started by trying to design it. So Eric, myself, and Shura sat in a room for quite some time and said, oh, yeah, that's great. We'll just design it. And so we actually came up with a handful of designs. We tried them all, and they all failed. Okay, but the idea was, let's try to design a tether that's not cleaved in the cells and enables ribosome assembly. And this is how we got around the challenge. So first of all, this is a cartoon schematic of the large ribosomal RNA subunit shown in gray. It's depicted here in its three-dimensional structure. And you have the start position and the end position of that RNA. So the way transcription occurs, you have a machine that hops on to the DNA that encodes this, and it makes this ribosomal RNA molecule. This is a cartoon depiction of the small subunit ribosomal RNA, again, with the start and stops. And so one idea, of course, would be to simply say, well, here's a start and a stop position. I could read through all of this ribosomal RNA, come to where the stop is, and make a long RNA linker to this position, and then read this part here. And that would be a way to make a single long chimeric RNA piece. The challenge is that this is 170 angstroms apart, and Eric can tell you that RNases cleave this. And so then the next idea that we started to think about was, how could you imagine grafting these two subunits together? So you do see that there are interfaces here. So you could imagine, well, let's somehow link these two together, creating some stretch of an umbilical cord, and by grafting the 23S and 16S ribosomal RNA with bridges near the interface. And so we set out to approach the problem and solve it in this manner. And so in order to do so, we employed circular permutations to identify 23S ribosomal RNA sites that could be used to link the 16S ribosomal RNA. And the core concept of a circular permutation is that what you do is you take the initial start and stop sites. So we're leveraging the idea that in the crystal structure, the 5' and 3' ends of these ribosomal RNA pieces are near each other, and you can tie those ends up just simply by adding some nucleotides. What you can then do is open, along any helical element in this structure, a new start and stop. And so that's known as a circular permutation because you've permuted the start and stop site of this sequence. The issue is that this changes the order of ribosomal RNA transcription, which hence changes the order of ribosome assembly. And so now you're actually changing the way in which ribosomal proteins will begin binding onto ribosomal RNA because as the RNA comes off of the polymerase, ribosomal proteins begin to bind it instantaneously. And so first what we did is we asked, let's see if we can identify any circular permutation sites. So any permutation sites that enable us to permute the large ribosomal RNA but keep the cell alive. We weren't actually focused on tethering the subunits at this stage, but just keeping the cells alive. And so what we did is we took a library of 23S ribosomal RNA, we connected the ends, and then we began cutting to create circular permutants. In fact, Eric created 91 circular permutants representing every single outside helical element in the ribosomal subunit. And then what we did is we took a special cell of E. coli that lives exclusively off of a plasmid that encodes the normal ribosomal RNA. All of its normal 7 genomic copies of ribosomal RNA were inactivated. We then transformed our library of different plasmid constructs, we actually did this individually one at a time, into this strain. And then there's something special about this plasmid that allows us to negatively select or counter-select for it to kick it out. And we asked, could cells live exclusively off of this ribosome? And if they did, then that was a possible design space we could leverage to tether the large subunit to the small subunit. And so what we observed is out of those 91 constructs, 22, in fact, could fully support cell growth. Those are the ones shown in green in this crystal structure of the ribosome, where, again, we have here the small subunit shown here and the large subunit shown here. What's important to note is I'm going to take the ribosome here, I'm going to flip it 90 degrees, and you're now going to be having the surface or interface exposed side, which is shown here. We notice this small patch of green spots right at the interface where the large subunit and the small subunit would talk to each other. Fortunately for us, it happens to be that this area that we noticed had these green spots that enabled these circular permutations is also the area of the ribosome that ratchets the least, and it's furthest away from where the business end of the molecule is. So it's furthest away from where tRNA are delivered, amino acyl tRNAs are delivered to the ribosome, and furthest away from peptide bond formation. And so what we thought was, could we just take those circular permutation sites and now create a tether? So we created a single long piece of DNA that encoded this tethered ribosome by tying up these loose ends, creating two small tethers, that would enable us to get across this about 9 angstroms of distance. And we asked the question, could now this tethered construct enable us to support growth? We used the same assay with 7 copies of the ribosomal RNA inactivated. What we did is we transformed a library with different tether lengths into this strain. We kicked out the original wild-type plasmid and asked, can cells live exclusively off of this tethered ribosome construct? And so, in fact, they did. The increase in doubling time about 2-fold, so they were a little more sick, but we did observe some that could do that. And then what we did is we took the RNA from these cells and ran them out on a gel. And we observed that the 23S ribosomal RNA and 16S ribosomal RNA were very prominent in a normal E. coli cell. In our cell where we now have this tethered ribosomal RNA construct, you see the emergence of this 4.5 kilobase band. And then in a gel that we celebrated greatly over and can probably stare at for a very long time, Eric probably more than me, maybe not, I'm not sure. But anyway, so we saw the emergence of this very pure 4.5 kilobase sequence. So this is important for a few reasons. So first of all, what I've just shown you is we were actually able to create a cell that broke an assumption that people had about how the ribosome worked. So people thought that the ribosome required 2 subunits to function, and in fact, we now know that that's not true. So that's exciting from a biological and an evolutionary perspective, and we're starting to explore that with a variety of collaborators. But in addition, that sets up the idea that we can now create an orthogonal system based on this ribosome, where this ribosome allows us to now modify and mutate the active site while still keeping the rest of the cell alive. And so in fact, what Eric did next is he engineered an orthogonal ribo-T system that was committed to translating a particular orthogonal message. So the idea was now we have a standard E. coli cell with 2 ribosomal subunits that would allow the cell to synthesize the entire proteome. We created this dual translation system where now this orthogonal tethered ribosome construct, or ribo-T, was driven by the orthogonal specificity endowed by the small subunit Shine-Delgarno and the Shine-Delgarno interaction. And so we asked the question, could we actually evolve the ribosome in a way that would otherwise be impossible in a cell? So back to that original analogy, can we create a new chef, one that has never existed in biological systems before and, in fact, can't exist right now in biology today? Okay. And so the way we set out to do this was to tackle a problem known as protein stalling. So in fact, there are some sequences, leader sequences in RNA that is, or in the protein that can be translated, that cause the ribosome to actually stall. And one of those is known as the SEC-M sequence. And in fact, the ribosome will stall at a proline before it continues to translate later through a variety of mechanisms. And in fact, the 23S ribosomal RNA is implicated in this SEC-M stalling mechanism, but up to now it has been impossible to study mutated wild-type ribosomes, because in fact, if you would mutate the ribosome, you would kill the cell. It's a dominantly lethal mutation. And so what we wanted to ask is, could we create a library of ribosomal RNA active site mutants that would alleviate this SEC-M stalling, so allow us to create a chef that had a function that no natural ribosome would have? And we did this by creating 2 very simple constructs. One had this SEC-M, or this stalling sequence. Just one construct, but the SEC-M stalling sequence in front of the LACC protein. And what would happen is if our cell that read the orthogonal message would arrest or not be able to read through the sequence, we would get a white color on a plate due to a beta-galactosidase assay. But if it were somehow these mutations we made to the ribosome were able to read through the sequence, we could actually see and observe a color. And again, I reiterate that any of these mutations that I'm talking about would be dominantly lethal, even if present in a very small fraction of wild-type ribosomes. So the good news for us very early on was that the mutant orthogonal ribosomes remain viable. So that was a key step that taught us that at least this wasn't toxic. But we then identified that this library could give us mutants. So in fact, when we applied a mutant library, mind you, it's only a series of 16 mutants, okay? But we looked at these 16 mutants. You could very quickly and easily, even from the back row, I believe, note that there are some blue colonies on this plate. So that told us that we're able to read through this stalling sequence. And in fact, we sequenced those, the winners, so the ones that had the blue colonies, and they all converged to a very specific sequence, in particular this A2451C mutation. So that's exciting because it endowed now our ribosome with a new function. And so what have I told you or tried to share with you today? So I think the idea of the science was that we've created a ribosome with tethered subunits that can support cell growth on its own, but also can enable gain-of-function mutations. So this is exciting because it allows us to now have mRNA decoding, peptidyl transferase, and protein excretion be controlled by the engineer in an orthogonal translation system for the first time. This is important for a few reasons. So first of all, I'd like to reiterate that in all kingdoms of life, the ribosome is composed of two subunits. So this is actually a sculpture at Cold Spring Harbor Laboratories, which has given me a chance to shout out for Julius here, who actually initiated a Cold Spring Harbor Labs course in synthetic biology that's still very actively running. And so we're delighted that he's here for that. He invited me. That's why I got this nice picture of the sculpture. But you can see that there are these two subunits. And actually, they move and they break apart. Our new tethered construct that Eric and Cedric created breaks this paradigm. So that's extraordinarily exciting. And we think that that has a lot of interesting applications for evolutionary and biological systems. But in addition, now for the first time, the large subunit of the ribosome is an engineerable substrate. We can now imagine optimizing the large subunit to express and synthesize new types of polymers, new types of substrates, new types of functions. And so we're looking towards a future where we can begin to repurpose ribosomes to offer new opportunities in these designer translation systems for making things like new biological polymers, but also for directing genetic programs as virtual machines. So, more broadly, the one thing I didn't talk about is, of course, all of the work that we do in cell-free systems. But I think, in general, the efforts that our lab pursues and the wonderful team that we have together is seeking to really transform biochemical engineering with synthetic biology and bringing new opportunities for not only designing ribosomes for sequence-defined polymers and evolvable matter, but also we are pushing rapid on-demand biomanufacturing of antibodies and different types of glycoconjugate vaccines. You'll hear actually some connections potentially to some of the ideas Jim will be talking about. We're looking at precision protein synthesis for studying post-translational modifications in both phosphorylation but also in glycosylation. And we're looking towards sustainable synthesis of chemicals and materials through a new paradigm of metabolic pathway prototyping. So just to highlight again, you know, I want to graciously thank Eric, whose story I talked about today. I actually kept it simple to just one story for a purpose. But really, I have a fantastic team of collaborators and students that makes my job fun. So thank you to all of you and for making that a really exciting time. And also, I'd like to thank again the David and Lucille Packard Foundation and DARPA for funding and a fantastic cast of collaborators that I get to work with in a somewhat frequent basis. But before I end, I just wanted to come back to where we started, which is that I'd like to imagine this world where synthetic biology offers new opportunities for redefining the way in which we as humans work with our world, and that programming living matter is really going to offer some exciting things. So we have, of course, a history of synthetic biology, which is still somewhat new. In fact, we have Jim's toggle switch here, which many look towards as one of the pioneering developments and initiations of synthetic biology, which was published around the same time as a biological oscillator that came out of the Elowitz lab. We have the start of the synthetic biology X.0 series. I just learned, actually, and Jim confirmed it today, the 7.0 is evidently going to be in Singapore in next year. You have the NSF Synthetic Biology Center, a creation of an organism from a chemically synthesized genome, new directions in considering the ethics and emerging of synthetic biology and emerging technologies, and then really an investment by the university here at Northwestern to put Northwestern on the map. And this really started with Linda Hickey and with Jay Walsh, who really pioneered a lot of investment in something that Josh and I started. With working on not only this Dean Centennial Lecture, but putting together this Biology by Design Symposium. And then really the emergence of this fantastic cast of characters that's coupled with these fantastic new technologies. And how Milan, for example, coming into the picture not only drives leadership for us as a core, but brings the same types of tools that have been applied for decades to small molecule and drug discoveries into the synthetic biology realm. And I think we're really exciting to look to see how we can leverage that, as well as advances that continue to come out of not only this group, but others with the start of the new center. So with that, I'm really excited about what the center has going on in its future. The the pillars of excellence that we will continue to pursue, and would just like to thank again the administration for their tremendous support of getting this effort up and running off the ground, and really celebrating the different advances from everything that Josh has done to getting things started, with Keith being really one of the people that's received 10% of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation grants in synthetic biology out of the original 30, which is a statistic I like to say, to now having this new cast of characters with Netta really bringing the systems analysis perspective, Julius and Danielle joining the crew, and really looking forward to bringing on just a fantastic new directions and opportunities for us here. So with that, I will stop and close, and thank you again. I can take a couple questions, I suppose, but if you have, yeah, go.
You mentioned the doubling time is double.
Uh-huh.
Do you know whether that's ribosome biogenesis, catalytic rate, error frequency, what generates
that? Yes, so there are two. So the question is, we have a cell that lives exclusively off of a tethered ribosome construct. Why does it grow more slowly? And the answer is probably two main reasons. So one is that, in fact, we know translation initiation in these cells is impaired, which would be expected because actually they don't separate. So that we believe is the major cause, although we also know there is a contribution from poor assembly, just because if you just take the large ribosomal RNA subunit RNA alone and do the circular permutation, you get impaired growth on that alone. So it's not just the tethering and initiation, it's actually a combination of both. Good question. Yeah, Rex.
The stutter or pause that you eliminated is something that's actually used biologically for translational regulation. Do you know anything about translational regulation in your artificial ribosome?
So we don't yet, but we actually, so translational regulation is something that Shura studies. So in fact, he basically works on a lot of different translational pausing mechanisms, and we're beginning to use now this machine and this engineered construct to be able to study that more directly. But insofar as do we know the exact mechanisms of how our system is working yet, the answer is no. Okay, super. Well, we will end there because the main event is on its way. What I'm going to do is, as we transition here to our next talk, I'd like to introduce Jim Collins while I pull up his slides very briefly. I'll be honest when I can say that it's just with so much gratitude that I express, your ability to come and join us here today. So Jim, as Milan mentioned, is a professor. In fact, he's the Tamir Professor of Bioengineering in the Department of Biological Engineering and Institute for Medical Engineering and Science at MIT. He's also deeply affiliated with the Broad Institute and the Wyss Institute, and really is one of the world-renowned pioneers in the field of not only synthetic biology and systems biology, and has a particular focus to using and thinking about network biology approaches to study everything from antibiotic action to bacterial defense mechanisms. Jim's scientific accomplishments have been recognized in numerous awards, and just to highlight a few, he received the NIH Director's Pioneer Award, the Ellison Medical Foundation Senior Scholar Award in Aging, a Sanofi Institute Pasteur Award, the Lagrange Prize, was selected as one of Technology Review's inaugural TR100 Young Innovators, and in 2003, as was mentioned earlier, he received one of the MacArthur Genius Awards. Really, he's been a pioneer at not only understanding biological systems, but transforming that into technological innovations that are being used, and in particular, we've seen multiple companies arise from work in his laboratory, as well as noting that his patented technologies have been licensed to numerous, more than 20 biotechnology companies. He's also a fellow of the American Physical Society and the American Institute for Medical and Biological Engineering. And as Milan mentioned, Jim is an elected member of the National Academy of Sciences, the National Academy of Engineering, the Institute of Medicine, the American Academy of the Arts and Sciences, and was one of the charter fellows of the National Academy of Inventors. So with that, I would like to thank Jim for coming, and we're delighted to have you.
change the center of mass for the field because you split the difference.
Well, the closer they just go.
I guess so. It didn't feel that way on that flight.
I think it can really become a center of mass for the field, and I'm just so happy to be here with you today. What I want to do is really just have some fun and share with you some of the things that we've been doing in synthetic biology and give you some sense of where the field came from and where it's going. So let's see. I was given the challenge to figure if I could. Okay, just down. There we go. So my background's not in molecular biology. So I started out in physics. And my initial interest was in nonlinear dynamics and complexity, similar to Julio. And Julio and I overlapped in the 90s. And in fact, my interest in biology was really looking at whole body dynamics. So we studied how people walk, how people run, how people maintain balance. So among other things in the 90s, we, for example, discovered that you could deliver small vibrations to the soles of subjects' feet and help them balance better. So we could develop vibrating insoles and take a 75-year-old and have them balance as well as a 25-year-old. How would a guy like me end up coming to talk to you about this new field where we're reprogramming organisms? Well, it goes back to about the mid-90s. So when some of, it's so nice to see so many young people, so many of you were just kind of starting to move around early in your life. And at Boston University, which is where I first started, my chair was Charles Cantor, who was one of the early pioneers in the human genome effort. And the dean of our College of Engineering was Charles Alessi. He had conceived of the human genome effort. In the mid-90s, the human genome effort was the thing happening in American science. Every other week on Science and Nature, it was a story about the human genome effort. And intriguingly, biomedical engineers, and more broadly, engineers, did not play a big role in the genome effort. So biomedical engineering back then had not gone molecular. So we were very much like little kids in a candy store looking, trying to figure out how we can go and play. And the two Charleses encouraged me to see if I could take my nonlinear dynamics notions and help on the genome effort. So around 95, 96, you started seeing parts lists coming out of these sequencing schemes. And they introduced me to Eric Lander, who I now work with the Broad, and Lee Hood, before systems biology existed. And 201, the leaders in these efforts said, Jim, what we need are guys like you, physicists, engineers, to begin now to reverse engineer cellular networks. Again, now from a system standpoint, before they had systems biology, that is, they said the interesting biology is going to be to figure out how genes, proteins work in networks. Now, at the time, microarrays had just appeared, literally had just appeared. They cost about $2,000 a pop, very expensive if you had no budget, no grants in the era, and there were no publicly available data sets. So the idea that you could reverse engineer a cellular network in 1996 was ludicrous. So with one of my star students, Tim Gunner, we ran as fast as we could away from that problem. Now, this is a part, I assume there's a number of engineers in the room. So you really have two kinds of kids who become engineers, right? The kids who take stuff apart in your house to try to figure out how it works, right? So they take apart your radio. They take apart your lounge chair. Rarely, if ever, do they put it back together. But nowadays, in this age of maintaining their self-esteem, you applaud their curiosity. You don't scold them. When I was growing up, you got scolded when you did that. Anyways, those are the kids who become systems biologists, right? It's actually only a small set. Most engineers aren't doing that. The young engineers that are typical are the tinkerers. They're the kids in my day who had erector sets or tinker toys. You went into attics, you went into garages, you made stuff, you made go-karts out of putting things together. And really that's what drove many of us into engineering. And so with Tim Gardner, my star, we sat back and said, well, could we do tinkering in biology? We knew nothing about biology. So Tim was a mechanical engineer out of Princeton. He designed autonomous helicopters as part of his undergrad project. We dug in and said, well, what could we do? And so this is around 1997, and sat back and realized that we could actually, like electrical engineers, come up with a circuit schematic and model it, again, just as an electrical engineer. But now instead of finding a resistor, capacitor, inductor, we would find biological components of the type of parts that Milan mentioned at the start. So could you find promoters? Could you find bits of genes? Could you find proteins, other RNA, other bits of DNA? And now instead of breadboarding them using soldering, could you use enzymes in a cut-and-paste fashion to get them into different plasmids or constructs, and then get them potentially into cells to see if they function. It was a foreign notion at the time in the late 90s that you would think about actually engineering a circuit. Well, we didn't have any money. So we kind of sat back and thought, okay, what could we do? And we cycled through many ideas over the course of about 9 months. So if I see, again, a lot of young people. So on grad students here, don't fall in love with your first idea. Try to generate as many ideas as you can. And Tim and I really went through many, many different possibilities. And we had two criteria. One, it had to be interesting enough to be worthy of study. but simple enough that we could analyze it and maybe build it. And so from playing around with a number of things, what we decided to finally settle on was this idea of a genetic toggle switch that Mike mentioned in his talk at the end. So this was motivated from electrical engineering. So toggle switches are flip-flops or RS latches, are very simple memory elements that basically are bistable switch that from a transient pulse of electrical signal can be flipped from 0, 1, or on, off. So how would you do this in a molecular biology? Well, this is shown here schematically. What we did was we came up with the idea you could have two promoters, so on switches for your genes that were constitutive. By constitutive, it means they always want to be on. You then have them drive two genes that would each produce proteins that would try to shut each other off. Okay, and you could have whatever you want on the other side to turn things and make, but say in this case, repressor 1, its protein would be designed to bind to the on switch of repressor 2, shutting it off, and the protein produced by repressor 2 would bind to the on switch of repressor 1, shut it off. They each want to be on, but you've engineered a mutually inhibitory circuit where they're each trying to shut each other off. In principle, you should be able to design it so it's a bistable system, and that is it wants to exist in one of two states. Either state A, gene 1 is on, gene 2 is off, or state B, gene 2 is on, and gene 1 is off. And in principle, you should be able to flip it between those states by transiently delivering a chemical that would shut off the currently active gene, allow the gene that had been kept off but wanted to be on to come on, produce enough protein to shut off that gene that you just shut off with the chemical, remove the chemical, and flip the state. Similar to just kind of walking in a room and flipping on light switches. You don't have to keep your finger on the switch as you would for a pressure switch. Well, as I said, we had no money to do this, so we did what most engineers and physicists do. We didn't try to build anything in lab. We tried to just model it. So with Tim, we basically did a 20-parameter, 20-dimensional system that, with encouragement, got him to collapse it down to just basically a two-dimensional coupled ODE model that's captured here. It's basically a competing species model. Okay, so what you've got is U is the protein concentration from gene 1, V is the protein concentration from gene 2. You've got alpha 1, alpha 2 are effective synthesis rates. And in this case, beta and gamma are measures of coactivity of basically the repression of the repressors at their promoter sites. Okay, so you've got a production term and a degradation term. If you took one of Julio Atino's nonlinear dynamics classes for undergraduate in nonlinear dynamics, what you would do is you do your analysis where, in this case, you're going to do a steady state analysis. Oddly, most nonlinear dynamics is not looking at dynamics, it's steady state. So you're going to set these equations equal to zero. And now what you can do is solve algebraically these systems where you're going to look at now your noclines, where, provided you put in some nonlinearity, beta and gamma greater than 1, which you get for free in molecular biology when you have multimerization of your repressors. So if you've got a dimer or a tetramer, you're going to get this nonlinearity built in. If you also balance them, well, what you're going to get is these guys are going to be sigmoidally shaped in protein-protein space. If they're balanced, that is, each gene is more or less of similar strength, which is really hard to do from an actual design standpoint, those noclines will intersect at three different points, corresponding to three different steady states or fixed points. The middle guy, where both genes are on, is unstable. The system doesn't want to sit there. And for those of you who have wet labs, you know it's really noisy inside these cells. So if it's unstable, you're not going to be there. Whereas these other two are fixed points that are stable. Corresponding to those states, state A, gene 1 is on, gene 2 is off, or state B, gene 2 is on, gene 1 is off. I can go on for 50 more minutes on all different dynamical analyses, these and other circuits. I'm not going to do that. But I will tell you an anecdote. In 1998, with only this in tow, Tim and I went and talked to probably about six different life scientists. Again, we had no background. And back then, they were transparencies. So we're going to share our transparencies, our results. And the meetings usually went as follows. We'd flip through, there's multiple slides like this. What do you think? Oh, very interesting, guys. Do you think it can work? No. Well, why don't you think it can work? When they go on, they had some interesting points. It's how are you going to get actual balance that you want on this? It's fine that your lines intersect like that, but goodness gracious, inside the cell, how are you going to balance it? How are you going to prevent leakage? That you've got these guys you want really tight off, you're going to get leakage, it's going to spill over, you're not going to get the two states really in one on, one off. The cell's not going to like this going in. It's very complicated inside, and invariably they would end by ushering us out of their office, patting us on the head and say, guys, stick to engineering. Biology is really complicated. Well, we didn't get discouraged. And I encourage young people not to get discouraged. We turned to Charles Cantor, who I mentioned was my chair, and we went to Charles and said, what do you think? He said, I got two answers for you. One, it's a crazy enough idea, I think it can work. And two, you two are so naive about how hard this is going to be. I put my money that you two clowns can actually figure out how to get this to work. At the time I was untenured, he was my chair. I says, please do not put that in my tenure letter. But I like your encouragement. And he actually opened up his lab to us and gave us a very small part of a bench where Tim, with help from folks in Charles' lab, learned how to do biotechnology, recombinant DNA, and just very quickly began to make plasmids based on these toggle switches. So I won't go through in detail, but you basically have different promoters and different repressors. We actually played with three different repressors, LAC, that can be induced with IPTG sugar. We did temperature-sensitive C1. Lambda repressor can be induced with heat shock, and we did the TET repressor, which can be induced with tetracycline. Okay? You then had the respective promoters, so we can do a chemical-chemical toggle or a chemical temperature toggle. We also then used GFP to report on one side of the state, and we had this in E. coli. Hey, so what do? We made plenty of monostable toggle switches. That's trivial to do. You make your circuit architecture, the great, great, great majority of toggle switches will be monostable. That is, one side is dominant, and you will not have a true bistable system. One side will be stable, the other side will be stable. Very easy to do. Tim was able to cycle through as an engineer would in parallel, and in just 9 months, which is still about the time it takes all of us 16 years later to build circuits, this guy got monostable toggle switches. So what I'm going to show you just pretty quickly are results from his temperature chemical toggle. So in this case, he starts it in the off state. In the off state, GFP is off, LAC is on, and C1 is off. He hits it with IPTG, which turns LAC off and allows GFP and C1 to come on. He can remove the inducer, and these guys are bistable, so it will stay in the on state. And we've looked out many days, which are many generations given E. coli will divide every 20 minutes. You can then whack it with heat shock, and it'll go from the on state to the off state, and that off state will stay stable out for many days as well. You can then look at the switching threshold, which for biosensing applications, and I'll share a couple in a few minutes, is critical. Can you have a sharp switching threshold? Well, given that this system is nonlinear, as built in, it actually had a very sharp switching threshold. So in this case, it's just sensing the presence of an inducer, a certain amount of inducer. I'm sorry. So in this case, what you've got is that here there's low concentration of the inducer. The cells are in the off state. At very narrow window of concentration, the cells in that population begin flipping. From here, in this point two, they're all in the off state. At point three, some in the off, some in the on. By point four, they're all in the on state. You can also look at switching dynamics. In this case, we initially started with high copy plasmids. So for the non-biological folks in here, that's basically you have about 80 to 100 copies of these things inside each cell, which I still have a real trouble getting my head around at the microscopic level. But anyways, these things would take about 6 hours to flip from, in this case, the off to the on state. And there are many, many different reasons for that, mainly due to you're waiting for basically the dilution of the LAC-bound IPTG or IPTG-bound LAC from cell division. But to go now from the on to the off, it only took about 20, 25 minutes. And there, it's mainly that you're just waiting. In this case, lambda repressor is stuck on the DNA. You hit it with heat shock, the lambda repressor destabilizes, falls off, and now you just have the machinery of transcription and translation to come on. So what do we do? Well, this was an ad that came out, actually based in part on our work shortly after we published. It's one of the best business spin-outs in American business history. So this was an ad announcing the spin-out of Accenture from Arthur Andersen that was just months later going to implode from backing Enron. Well, before that happened, they had these fluorescing cells. And again, be careful for those folks who don't go into science, you join business, which is your marketing firm, because they say bacteria tested his digital circuit. Now it gets interesting. These are enucleated cells, so they're not bacteria. But it's a beautiful ad anyway that captured really what we did. We had now taken inspiration from electrical engineering, and we had reprogrammed bacterial cells, endowing them with addressable memory, just as you would a cell. And got very excited about this. And again, now, you know, nobody was kind of doing these things. We first presented this at a DARPA workshop on amorphous computing. And as you begin now thinking about, you're programming cells with memory, could you now maybe have E. coli-based computers? And there was a lot of talk about this in 1999. When we first presented this, and I did this at the American Academy, again with my transparencies, and I'm going through this, the room was getting electrified. Wow, these guys have done it. We have a genetic toggle switch. And I said, oh, hold your horses. And I put up that last slide. I said, it takes 6 hours for this thing to flip. No more air in the room. Why? Well, the machines everybody carries around, your life extension of your brain, where you can check things, loaded with millions of toggle switches. But these things take tiny, tiny fractions of seconds to switch. So you're not going to have a machine that has E. coli inside its little label to surf the web. Imagine if you did. You know, you're going to call up 4 days later, you know, weather.com, oh, if I knew it was going to be 60 degrees here, I would have worn something differently. So wrong way to think about biocomputing, but the right way, and really a dominant theme in synthetic biology, is the idea that you can program cells to do interesting things in multitudes of environments. And that is really a dominant theme, and it's something we got excited about going back about a dozen years ago with Hideki Kobayashi and Mads Kern, where we thought, wouldn't it be cool if you could take now these engineered circuits in a plug-and-play fashion and couple them to interesting input or output pathways that have evolved for millions, in some cases billions of years in living organisms, to create now cells that can sense things, make a decision, and do something in their environment. What we did very quickly, I won't spend a lot of time on it, was then take the toggle switch. The beauty of the toggle switch, it can provide you memory. You can sense something, remember it, and then report on it later, interface with the humans. And just what we did here was create a sensor to detect DNA damage. So there are beautiful DNA damage sensing pathways, repair pathways in E. coli. For interest of time, I won't go into the genetic details, but we coupled it beautifully to it and found that it worked really well going back a dozen years ago. So one of the key things you want with any sensor, right, is low false positive rate. So the smoke alarms back in your office, smoke alarms back in your dorm rooms, you don't want going off unless there's smoke and there's a fire. You don't want your anthrax detector in the beautiful quad here in Northwestern going off unless there's anthrax. Well, this thing was out stable. We looked in this case just 2 days, again, out probably 4 days so far. Very stable. And then when you whack it with different DNA damaging agents, either chemotherapy, mitomycin C, or UV radiation, this thing actually behaved as a beautiful rheostat. It would flip on depending upon how much it was exposed to. And back a dozen years ago when we introduced this, it was more sensitive than the best commercially available DNA damage sensor at the time. I know there's a lot of interest here in the Chicago campus and here in the center. I'm moving toward medical, and that's really where most of my interests are. And just a year and a half ago, we teamed up with Pam Silver on the idea, could you program bacteria to serve as living diagnostics? And what we did was we took a toggle switch, put it into E. coli Nissl, a probiotic strain that's used widely in Europe, to just create a simple sensor. In this case, it just reported on the presence or absence of an antibiotic in a host environment. Host environment is nasty, very hostile. And depending on discussion time and reception, we talk about the big challenge in the field is, can you make circuits that really function the way you like for when you want them to function and for a long time? Well, it turned out that these sensors actually work beautifully in a mouse environment, in the gut of the mouse, and could report for on the order of about 2.5 weeks with stable output on presence or absence of antibiotic. As part of a microbiome center at MIT, we're now extending this to create living diagnostic probiotics that can, among other things, report on inflammation. So a big focus of our microbiome center is inflammatory bowel disease, Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis. So I'm sure there are people in this room that have impacted either directly or with family members. I have a son who is struggling with ulcerative colitis. If you're a kid with ulcerative colitis and you have to go get a colonoscopy, you have to clean yourself out as anybody would for a day before, which is hard for a young teenager. And then they bring you in the hospital, they put you out under general anesthesia. Put you full procedure, and then you have to go through all the challenges of that. We're now working, can you engineer the bug to report on do you or do you not have inflammation? That's easy. We've already got that worked out. So you would take a pill. If your stool turns blue in a specific way, you have evidence of inflammation. The more critical and the challenge to you think about it as you get bored at different parts of my talk for the young biological designers here is, how do you engineer the bug to report on where the inflammation is? You've got a long track, and if it's IBD, you're going to basically be, you know, small intestine, large intestine of interest. Can you report on where it's at to give insight? And we have some ideas, and I'd be curious if you can come up with ones as well. The other big effort in our lab, and I'll just show one on this, is we're really pushing hard now on engineering bugs to serve as living therapeutics. And we got one of the SynBio grants, so we might have 3% out of Gates, a few years ago to engineer bugs to detect and treat cholera. So what we've done with you and Cameron in our lab is basically take a probiotic, L-lactis, that you find in yogurt, and we've endowed it with circuitry that actually has an AND logic gate, two-input AND logic gate that responds to two different infection signals produced by cholera. If it detects those, it actually then flips on the production of antimicrobial peptides that will go after cholera. Sounds nice, schematic. We've got each of the parts working well. It is really hard to get stuff out of bugs at a high concentration that can be medically relevant. And we now have a very talented new postdoc, Andres Cubos, who has figured out he's actually lysing the cells now to produce antimicrobial peptides. It turns out, again, schematically, SynBio, it's really easy to do a lot of these things, but it's really hard to actually put it into practice. We now can kill cholera beautifully in a dish, which has limited applicability. We're now moving toward mouse studies, and the vision is that you could have this and broader infection control, where in the face of a cholera outbreak, for example, post-earthquake Haiti, to actually have these given as pills or spiked into yogurt. And the beauty of this, once you make it, it could be cheap to produce two. You actually would have it if you engineered it well. They would only produce the problematic antimicrobial peptides that are going to mess up some of your microflora only if you are infected. Right? So it's not that it's constitutively expressed. It has to detect and then make. And we're now expanding this to other schemes, but we also got quite excited that we got approached by venture groups a couple years ago. They were quite interested in infection, and the Gates group came on to go after difficult-to-treat infections. But these guys moved us into areas I didn't appreciate, which is Synlogic's now raised about $75 million to go after rare genetic metabolic disorders, things like urea cycle disorders, or PKU, where in a small cohort of kids, they're born without ability to actually process toxic metabolic byproducts. And they've now got great animal work, and they're moving to clinical trials within a year to actually engineer the bugs to process those problematic metabolites. And they just announced a big deal a month ago with AbbVie. So AbbVie actually produces, I think it's Humira. So Humira is the number one selling drug. And by that, I think it just makes the most money. So I don't know how many they actually sell. But it's actually used to treat IBD. And they're teaming up with Synlogic to go after IBD, really to replace Humira, which I'm very excited about. Okay, so I'm sure Lori and others are hearing what I'm saying and getting very concerned about different phrases I'm using or different points I'm raising. And that's happened in the field, right? You get concerned when you say, a guy says, I don't have any background in molecular biology. And so there are engineers mucking around in a molecular biology lab. You get concerned in Boston, is something going to come out of Jim's lab and eat Fenway Park? God help you. Well, you know, the field, I think, has nicely engaged the public, more so than any other field I've been in. I think we've nicely engaged the ethics community appropriately. I think the field, unfortunately, has been bedeviled by hype. The field is still small, so for the young folks, I encourage you to read everything you can that's academic. And so on the original papers, there's still only probably 100, 150 papers. Oddly, as a field, there are about 100, 150 review articles as well. So about one-to-one. I've contributed several of those, so I'm not saying it as criticism. But there's tens to hundreds of newspaper magazine articles that you can also read. The field's been hyped up to no end. And as if the hype meter couldn't go any higher, Craig Venter entered the field. This isn't Craig, but this is a magazine cover that reported on Craig's announcement that Mike shared back in May 2010, so it was 6 years ago. And what Craig's team did was technologically brilliant, I thought. They took an extant mycoplasma, they sequenced its genome, they then sent out parts of it to be synthesized by different groups, brought those parts in, put it together as a full genome, put a few watermarks in it, introduced it into a related mycoplasma, rebooted it, and got that organism to replicate with the synthesized genome that was based on a natural genome. Again, amazing all the steps they did. It got presented as that man-made life. Craig, I don't think, disavowed some of the reporters who gave the sense they had created life, leading to problematic and interesting situations where both the Pope and Obama on the same day commented on Craig's work. So peer review I've never had. Peer review I hope to never have. Well, anyways, I think we need to, and I'm really delighted that the center has an ethics program headed by Lori. We need to engage it. I went to a Jesuit school, Holy Cross, which is also purple. So I have a lot of purple ties in my closet and love to engage those discussions. But I'm an engineer, so I also like to try to address the problems head on. So coming back a few years ago, we got excited. Could we address it head on by actually engineering solutions? So that is, as engineers, could we create biocontainment systems to that would be appropriate, not only put society, public at ease, but to actually keep this public safe should something inadvertently escape from your lab. Or if you've got to help you putting stuff in people's bodies, what happens if that person has a bad reaction? Could you get rid of it? What happens if, in fact, that passes through the person, goes in your water supply? Can you make sure you keep water supply safe? So I'll share just a few examples. We got excited about, could you program cells to count so that after out in the space for 5 hours or 5 days, they then commit cellular harikari? We're going to present two counting circuits that we built successfully in E. coli. First is by Ari Friedland, and each of these are based on a daisy chain cascade. So a daisy chain cascade, again, is common electrical engineering. It's an in-series circuit where you have n number of switches in place, where they're all off except the first guy. The first guy is not on, but it's primed to be on. It sees the first stimulus, it flips on, and then primes the next guy. The next guy then sees the stimulus again, it flips on, primes the next guy, et cetera. So it's as if you're going to run down a hallway, opening doors to get to the end of the hallway. What we did was introduce very tight RNA switches that would enable us to really keep the low leakage on the system. And we could then program cells. It was just a linear circuit to count to two or count to three. This is the schematic for the operation. But this is actual experimental data. Zero pulses. This is just seeing the first or the second pulse. So there was leakage. But when it saw in sequence the two, you had a robust output against which you could threshold. And similarly, you had leakage when you had count to three, but a robust output. Tim Liu, who's a star faculty now at MIT, and he was one of my star students, came with a different design. Still daisy chain cascade, but instead of using the RNA switches, he used recombinases. So what he has now is, with recombinases, you can have enzymes expressed that are going to chop a chunk of DNA out, flip it around, and reinsert it. So he set up his daisy chain so that the guy's primed to ready, first guy to respond to the enzyme or the input and then produce it. The guy downstream is off. When the DNA gets switched and reinserted, this guy gets primed. Well, it turned out this thing worked beautifully. Much lower leakage, beautiful robust output. And intriguingly, the first guy, the RNA switch, operated on the 20 to 40 minute time frame. So you could imagine coupling that to cell cycle. This operated on the 10 to 20 hour time frame. So you can imagine coupling it to a day cycle, sunlight and no sunlight. Well, could you do kill switches? Well, Jared Kalura in our lab, he actually designed a very simple one. I'll give you a more complicated one in the next slide. But it's, again, an AND gate. So it would need to see two stimuli. If it saw both, it would then flip on proteins, lytic factors, that would rapidly and readily kill off the bug. Two anecdotes to share on this. On the heels of Craig's announcement, and just so you know, Craig has another announcement coming tomorrow. He does. There's a news conference scheduled where they'll announce the next stage in their efforts on synthesis. It shouldn't generate as much intrigue, but it will be interesting. But on the heels of announcement in May 2010, what happened was President Obama charged his Bioethics Commission with their first task, which was go figure out what those SynBio guys are doing and make sure it's not dangerous. So they convened three public three public conferences, invited a bunch of us in. I presented our work up to about here and was happy that they actually highlighted this in their report as a much-needed safeguard in synthetic biology. And it led to two different DARPA programs to create more of these. Okay, that's nice. But more interestingly was when we published this, we got contacted by a number of biotech companies. And they said, Jim, we want to work with you. I says, why? Why do you want this? They says, we want your kill switch to protect against corporate espionage. And I says, tell me more, because your life sounds much more interesting than mine. And they said, Jim, we are worried that the summer intern's not a summer intern. That the summer intern is from a corporate competitor or from an enemy of the state. We're spending $500 million to engineer bugs to convert sunlight into fuel. What if somebody, the corporate competitor, got this, or a country that we're not friendly with got this, that could run untethered, et cetera. They were worried that on Friday afternoons during the volleyball game, when they run in to go to the bathroom, they're taking a jar into a big bioreactor, stealing out secret sauce, running out the door. So could you program these guys so that when you scoop them out, they explode? I said, yeah, that's easy. And they said, but we want you to do further. When they explode, we want you to chop up their DNA. And this is a true conversation. It's, okay, why do I got to chop up the DNA? I didn't know how to do it. For the young people, you know. You just ECOR1, which I'll show you result really fast. And they said, we're worried the bad guys might have Craig Venter tied up in the back room. Right? So when you explode your cell, you can still fish out your DNA. He could sequence it. And then, you know, to get free, he's got to synthesize it. Voila, that's their secret sauce. Anyways, just very quickly, what did we do? Well, what we published just about a month ago was the idea of a passcode kill switch. Relatively complicated. It's a little hard. It's kind of anti-logic to go through, but I'll try to go through it fast. It's basically an interesting system that involves three different transcription factors that can control the expression of a toxin. Okay, so it's easy. It's probably just walk through the logic of the circuit shown here. You've got two repressors here, or transcripts acting as repressors, trying to shut off the expression of this guy that's trying to shut off the toxin. Okay, so to survive, you don't want the toxin present. So if your goal is cell survival, you want to make sure that you're not inducing C, which would prevent that guy from being present and it would make the toxin. Okay, so C is the chemical that shuts your transcription factor, big C, off. Okay, And you want to make sure that neither of these guys, because they can bind to the same site, are present. Because if either of them is present, then it would shut off the production of this guy. Boom, toxin is there. Well, the trick on this was we actually, Clement Chen designed what are, we call hybrid transcription factors. So again, going to Milan's really nice intro, talking about parts and components, it turns out there really aren't that many parts that are being used. Biology is loaded with diversity of parts. And so for the young people, I challenge you to go out there, read molecular biology cell, try to read molecular biology cell, try to read these pieces, try to find more parts you can utilize. There's only about 24 parts, if you did an analysis of the SynBio literature, that have been used and reused. Clement just quickly recognized in the LacGal transcription factor family that on the basis of a beautiful sequence analysis, he could actually distinctly identify and separate the allosteric response module, that which responded to the inducer, from the DNA binding module of it. So he could mix and match and flip the two so that you could now create systems that would bind to the same operating site but respond to different inducers. Well, what you then have is this would be an example of a kill switch where you've got this guy is going to bind to this scheme from the LacGal system but would be induced by IPDG. Here's one that would be induced by Gal but bind to the LAC operator site. Here's one that would be induced by cellular BIOS but also bind to the LAC operator site. You've got three different inputs with on-off, so it's 2 to the 3. Right? So your truth table, you've got 8 possibilities. Of the 8, only one will allow your cell to survive. Right? So your passcode for survival is you better not have IPDG, because your toxin will be expressed otherwise, and you have to make sure you've got both of these inducers or else you're going to shut it off. So 0, 1, 1, and all of your other possibilities would ensure you for cell death. The beauty of the passcode to get after corporate espionage is you can change up very readily whichever hybrid transcription factor you have. So you can very quickly in the lab after you made your general design change things up. And that's in fact what Clement did. So he built these and then very quickly tested these so that he could readily get after ones with different passcodes where only the one situation allowed these bugs to live, all the others would die. Okay. Michael, in his very nice intro, mentioned we do a lot of work on antibiotics. I want to share with you two very quick case studies of what we've been doing in SynBio around antibiotics. Why we're in this space is captured scarily in this plot. As many of you know, with antibiotics, the number of resistant strains is growing. It's been going on decade for decade. This largely was limited to hospitals. As I tell my students, worst place to be when you're sick is a hospital. Get out as fast as you can. Why? Because these bugs are going to get you. Right? But now it's not limited to hospitals. These resistant bugs are on college campuses, they're on playing fields, they're in childcare centers. It's a big problem. That's coupled, unfortunately, with the situation on the right. The number of new antibiotics being developed and approved has been dropping decade upon decade. Big pharma is getting out. It economically doesn't make sense. The antibiotic business is about a $20 billion market that's chopped up smallly. For most cases, you're going to take an antibiotic for a week or 2 weeks, your Z-Pak. So it's a tiny bit. Generics are working pretty fine. It's not a big market. So I don't fault pharma for that. They're generally going after chronic conditions. If it's going to cost me $500 million or $1 billion to develop a small molecule, I'm going to develop one, if I'm a corporate executive, to go after cancer or metabolic neurological disorders now. I don't fault them on that. What I do fault them on, stunning fact that a friend of mine, Scott Singleton, shared with me, which is that there are more lifestyle drugs in development in pharma than there are antibiotics. Things like Viagra. My God, you know, we don't need any more of those. Right? I've explained to my 12-year-old while watching these ads during the Super Bowl, what does that mean, Dad? We don't need those. We got plenty of those. And we need to shift our priorities. Well, in our lab, we're not trying to develop new antibiotics. We're trying to develop new ways to treat and take advantage of our existing antibiotics. So just quickly, what Tim Liu did was actually engineer bacteriophage. What are these? Bacteriophage are viruses that only go after bacteria. So in this case, he engineered them so that you would deliver them with antibiotics to serve as antibiotic boosters. And specifically, they engineered them to overexpress a protein that would keep some of the defense systems that we discovered that play a key role to help the bacteria against the drugs. So we discovered that general class of antibiotics, like quinolones, like beta-lactams, like aminoglycosides, so penicillin, cipro, tobramycin, all produce DNA damage. If the bug can repair that damage, it's going to survive many of the treatment antibiotics. Tim had the idea, well, what if I, along with the antibiotic, would have a bacteriophage that would overproduce a protein that would keep the DNA damage response off? Could I make the antibiotic stronger? Well, it turns out he can. he found that he could make the antibiotics 100 to 10,000 times more effective at killing bacteria. He did the first animal studies that were done in SynBio to show you could work. If, for those of you who actually study these, you'll see that you go from about a 20% survival for low amount of antibiotic to 80% when you deliver with the phage. Now, you don't want 20% of your patients dying, but we did this on a shoestring budget. More interestingly, data I'm not showing is that Tim went further, and he actually looked at resistant strains, so strains that had grown resistant to a quinolone, and showed that when he co-delivered the phage, he could actually resensitize those strains to the original antibiotic. When we published this, we got immediately contacted by the U.S. Army and Walter Reed Medical Institute, and they shared with us, this was 2009, 2010, that young U.S. soldiers coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan were bedeviled, and they still are, by nasty skin wounds that had resistant bacterial infections, primarily acinobacteria, which were endemic to those regions that were not responding well to our antibiotics. And they challenged our groups, could we co-develop with them phage as a co-therapy? And Tim's been doing that charge with input from ours and making great, great progress. Second is the idea, could you use phage to go after biofilms? So what's a biofilm? A biofilm is a community of bacteria that is surrounded by an extracellular polysaccharide matrix that are attached to a surface. So the plaque on your teeth is an example of a biofilm. The stuff inside your sink is a biofilm in many cases. The stuff on the side of a ship is a biofilm. Why a bioengineer like myself is interested in biofilms is twofold. One is bugs in biofilms are 1,000 times more resistant to antibiotics than bugs not in biofilms. And two, bugs love to form biofilms on anything we put in your body that is intended to be a device. So if you get an artificial knee, artificial hip, pacemaker for your heart, pacemaker for your brain, which you might need at this point of the day before the reception in the midst of my talk, your number one risk in, when I was a kid, was general anesthesia. You're going to come out from general anesthesia. We're pretty good on that. Still a risk, but not big. Your number one risk now is you're going to get a biofilm infection. So in the case of a hip, and it happened to Charles Lissy, the dean who got me into this field, poor guy, he got an artificial hip, he got a recalcitrant biofilm infection. What do? They open you back up. They take your artificial hip out, they have you sit in a hospital room for a week or two, and then they reinsert a new hip. Oh, no thank you. I would rather go to a faculty meeting than go through that, which says a lot. So just briefly, what we did was we took the phage now and decided, could we use the phage as biofilm busters? And Tim came in and now made the phage lytic. So in the lytic mode, he had them originally lysogenic, where they're just going to make protein, be kind of happy. Now he's going to have them lytic, where they're going to make multiple copies of themselves, burst the cell, and now you have these additional progeny that can go and get after additional cells. Others have tried this for going after biofilms, but the challenge is the phage, you're not very good at penetrating the gunk of the biofilm. So just briefly, Tim's notion and what he executed on was, could he express on their surface enzymes that could break apart the biofilm, exposing more and more of the bugs? It worked brilliantly. So just the photograph is, here's a gunked up plate with biofilm, here's a treated after his enzymatic phage, here's control, this is with the very strong antibiotic ampicillin, about a 20% drop, strong cellulase by itself, 50% drop. Unmodified phage, about a 70% drop. Pretty good, but you're still infected. When he introduced enzymatic phage, he got north of 99.99%. He also made Trojan horse enzymatic phage, so not simply having them expressed on the surface, he had them express enzymes that could disperse, express inside the bug, so then when they lyse, would cause dispersion of the biofilm, so he had them express disperse in B. Got similar. North of 99.99%. I hope the center here, and I know, I don't think Chad is here, but I know there's a lot of entrepreneurial spirit here at Northwestern. I'm sure the center will capture that as well. I benefited from having very entrepreneurial students, Tim and then Mike Curris, work with Tim. They launched a company initially called Novophage around this. They entered these business plan competitions, did remarkably well in those, raised about $200,000, which gets you going, but you can't really build a company around that. They were going to do phage for clinical treatments. They went, talked to the venture guys. They says, we don't want anything to do with this. Regulatory barrier's too high. They says, we want you to go after industrial biofilms. Bioreactors, air conditioning systems, oil gas pipelines, paper mills, there's huge problems. They raised about $7 million. We're all excited. And they raised it on input from the EPA. The EPA says, okay, this could take about 2 to 3 months to get your stuff approved. They then went back to the EPA with earlier, and they said, who did you talk to? Because you're engineering, this is an engineered organism. No, you're not going down a 2 to 3 month, you're going down an 18 to 24 month path. And you know what, every time you change your cocktail, right, so the biofilm on the HVAC system on this roof will be different than that in Boston, which will be different than that in the Bay Area, you're going to have to come back and start it go again. They didn't want to do that. They didn't want to sell hope. They wanted to sell products. So brilliantly, they shifted their name. They shifted their focus to now developing a product that's out. It's a SynBio product that's using engineered phage to detect pathogens rapidly. So they have a product that actually detects food pathogens. So what a food company will do is on Fridays, they come in, they'll swab different spots. They'll, either the restaurant or the food packaging or processing, send it out to the lab. 48 hours, it comes back and says, ooh, you have a listeria problem. You have an shut down Chipotle. Well, you know, you just went 48 hours where you infected who knows who, how many folks. These guys can actually give an output without need to culture using the engineered phage in 4 hours, 6 hours max. So within shift, they can tell you, do you have a salmonella problem, E. coli problem, a listeria problem? And they're now moving toward clinical problems. Well, I want to end with just two case studies here alluded to by Mike. Very new stuff from our lab. So SynBio is really beginning now to have reach into many different application areas. And I'm confident, given all the marvelous things and folks you have here, that the new center is going to play a big role in all these different spaces. We're primarily on the medicine side. And you can envision, when you start thinking about living organisms, you don't want living cells in a lot of settings, including hospitals, your homes, out in the field. It can be very difficult to work with. So we got excited. Could you begin thinking about synthetic biology where you're not involving living cells? And we looked at Mike Jewett's work. We looked at Julius Lux, I mean, two of the biggest, best guys in this space. It's this really beautiful subcommittee within SynBio of looking at in vitro synthetic biology, and you have two of the world's best. And we are looking at what you can do. Really, our interest was, could you put these inside synthetic vesicles? Could you put it inside exosomes and have sentinels that could be even placed in your bloodstream to detect things? And we're back doing that. But in the midst of that, Keith Pardee, a very talented postdoc in my lab, sat back and says, what if I actually took these cell-free extracts and freeze-dried them? Okay, so what Mike and Julius have been playing with, you can kind of crack open a cell. You have several dozen enzymes. You've got the ribosome that we just talked to Mike shared with us. You've got nucleic acids, other schemes. You operate in solution. They operate as if it's inside a cell. You don't have the complexity around it, but you get interesting translation, transcription, other biological phenomena. Keith had the brainstorm of, well, what I've spotted on paper, freeze-dry, what happens? Well, what he found was that he could freeze-dry these synthetic constructs and then rehydrate them sometime later. And they would function as if they were in solution, or frankly, they could function as if they were inside a living cell. So with the work that Mike and Julius do, you'll typically take fresh from frozen stock and play with it. Keith ran a set of studies to see, did he lose any activity when he did his freeze-dried, and there was little of any loss of activity from the freeze-dried process. He then took these paper-based schemes and pellets as well, placed it in the drawer in his lab, and every month or so took them out. And he's now out well past a year, little if any loss of activity when stored at room temperature. So you can now begin thinking about distributing these in the field, sticking them in your pocket, going on a plane, bringing this somewhere. So could you now induce schemes? So just quickly, we looked at very simple circuits where could you now in this have a system that could respond to an input that was freeze-dried? And so you took a cell-free extract, introduced now simple circuits that, the toggle switch just went off, could be induced. So now what he's going to do, he's going to freeze-dry it, and he's going to basically rehydrate it with or without the inducer. And what he found was that he could actually induce robustly with these inducers on these freeze-dried schemes. Well, while we're doing this, we work with another really talented postdoc who's now a professor at Arizona State, Alex Green, where he designed so-called toehole switches, so RNA switches that, again, for interest of time, I won't go into the functionality, but these guys respond to trigger RNAs or other RNAs that if are present together, this A star, B star would combine with A and B, and thus if present will open up this stem loop structure that was preventing this gene from being expressed, that when opened up now allows the ribosome to dock on the ribosome binding site and making genes. Alex developed this initially to serve as an in vivo sensor. He showed you could have these function inside bacterial cells, happily detecting whatever you want them to detect. Keith wanted to see what had happened on his paper. Took dozens of these and just briefly found that he could freeze-dry them and then actually get very robust expression, 10 to 100-fold above baseline 20 to 25 minutes after he induced it. You don't want to have a fluorescent readout. Could you have a colorimetric readout, similar to what you have in a pregnancy test? So what the guys did was replace the fluorescent proteins now with LACZ. So LACZ, when expressed, if there's another enzyme present in the substrate, will cleave that enzyme. It'll change the color from yellow to purple. So now you don't have to look at plate reader out, but this is what was on Keith's desk. So the top is just a control. You don't have your inducible switches, whereas the bottom you have it. And after about 25 minutes, 30 minutes of induction, you begin to see a very distinct color change where you can actually quantify it quite nicely. We're at the Wyss Institute, which is part of Harvard. It's their bioengineering nucleation point. And with Tom Ferrand, Keith Pardee, Keith's now a professor at University of Toronto, they developed a printing scheme where they could print arrays of these just from a simple computer printer. You can now readily get after systems that could test either in the lab, in the clinic, or out in the field. Well, with Tom, he also developed a super cheap electronic optical reader, where in many cases you'd want to quantify your sensor, whether it's a research tool or a clinical tool. And this is a super cheap one that could actually, with Bluetooth, can send a signal to your cell phone or a PC. Well, what do we do next? Well, those RNA switches did not only respond to small little trigger RNAs that we could make, they could also respond to full mRNA that was endogenous, so the transcript from an expressed gene. So Alex and Ishii showed you could use these in vivo sensors. They could report on, is a gene being expressed inside the bacterial cell? Keith wanted to see, could you use this on taking a lyse sample out of a patient or out of a research to tell you, is a gene being expressed? And so he initially just used it to show that it could actually report on an expressed fluorescent protein. Not interesting, but a nice demo. From a medical standpoint, he then took on the challenge, could he actually use this to detect the presence of antibiotic resistance? So if you come into the hospital, into the emergency room as part of an accident, they're going to load you up with antibiotics. They're going to take a guess of what you might have, what you might need. In some cases, it's not the right antibiotic. They're going to send out, if you have indication of infection, so 48 hours, come back and say, oh, man, we gave him the wrong thing. So it'd be great, could we, within an hour, identify what are you susceptible and or is there presence of resistance? Keith very quickly developed sensors based on those RNA switches, designed them, validated them, to look at four different resistant genes to classic antibiotics, pictinomycin, chlorpheniclone, kanamycin, ampicillin, and got beautiful readout where you could scheme. He could. Now, the next big challenge was we were writing this up last summer, Alex and Keith, and it was in the midst of the Ebola crisis. We had already gotten interest from editor at Cell. They wanted this piece. And Keith and Alex slowed everything down and said, you know what? Let's see what we can do. Can we respond to the Ebola crisis? And what these guys did was remarkable. In under 12 hours, they designed, constructed, and validated 24 different sensors for Ebola. So what they did is you have five nucleoprotein mRNAs. They took one of them. They found regions that could respond or be trigger points for the RNA switch, 12 for the Sudan strain, 12 for the Zaire strain. They only used $20 worth of DNA material. Got this and got beautiful, robust readout. They could give you very strong expression signals, 20 to 25 minutes, dropping the sample on. They could set up full arrays you could do for different controls. They could actually discriminate between the Sudan and the Zaire strains. And so it was a really interesting way of how you could respond very quickly to an emerging crisis. So what do you have with this? Well, what I haven't shared to emphasize too much is we've basically broken the cold chain. So if you're going to use SynBio, which I think has huge potential out in the field, the challenge is that a lot of living material needs to be refrigerated. This removes it. Again, you can stick it in your suitcase, your pocket, get on a plane, go around the world, stick it in an envelope, send it around the world. It's cheap. Each of those sensors, we're now down to 2 cents if we use our homegrown version, 65 cents if we use the catalog version. You can have a colorimetric output, and you can couple it to an electronic reader. So I want to share just in the last 2 minutes is something I'm really proud of, and it was an interesting case study of academic research is about 6 weeks ago, challenged the team, could you do something similar with Zika? So we reached out to Keith and Alex, who had their own labs. We took advantage of Melissa Takahashi, who's my star new postdoc who'd been trained by Julius, and the team took on that challenge. So what they did in a matter of days, from start to finish, it was about 5 weeks to actually, we submitted a paper a week ago, is they developed 48 different sensors for Zika. So they came up with a new design. This was the older design for the toehold. They came up with a new design that had lower background off and higher robust output. where now they're targeting different regions of the RNA. What I didn't say, but you might have picked up, we are in the nanomolar regions, 10^-9, when we are looking at the Ebola. We got into the high picomolar. But with Melissa leading the charge, we actually did a RNA amplification scheme that takes only about 1.5 to 2 hours that enabled us with these sensors to be in the femtomolar region, so 10^-15. In serum, you need to be 1 to 3 up to 50 femtomolars for Zika. So we actually are in that region. You want to make sure you don't actually detect dengue. And this is a sequence-based scheme. And you can multiplex. So the beauty of SynBio is you can develop n number of these, have them all on a plate or on a piece of paper, and now go against different schemes. And we found that the kind of commiserate sequence in dengue were not triggering the sensors. We then coupled it to the electronic reader, so you can now read it in time as it comes out. And so within minutes, again, we can now be in 1 femtomolar to 3 femtomolar. And we went in excess. We're a BL2 lab at most. So we're not playing directly with Zika. We're doing chunks of Zika. But the team led by Melissa actually had the idea. They actually inserted chunks of Zika into a lentivirus and then actually saw, could you take that? And this was all done in serums. This is in blood serum. We're making these detections. They boiled the virus to expose it, make the amplification scheme. And this is now, in this case, we're in the 3 femtomolar. And before I left, we're now down to the 1 femtomolar. So we're really excited about how SynBio, I think, can be used to get after. Oh, I'm sorry. While you come up, I will. Let me talk to the slide. So we're looking in 3 different areas of where we're going with this. Diagnostics is one. So we do want to have a whole platform. We're now working with a Singapore effort at MIT to see, can we get this on the ground to go after a number of different viruses they're looking at. Intriguingly, when we announced this, reported this last fall, the feds did not contact us on Ebola. 2 weeks later, they contacted us, not on Ebola. BARDA wanted us to develop an at-home flu test. So they want to know, you know, if you're sitting there, do you have a cold, do you have a flu? If you have a flu, don't come in and infect Mike or Milan or some of the older faculty members. Stay home. If you have the cold, come on in. Work at the lab. You got it. You're fine. And so we're looking at that challenge. We're looking to see if you can move this toward cancer and other complex conditions. So I think there's a whole host on diagnostics that's promising. I'm delighted to see there's an educational component to the new center. I'm very keen on education. And we're now working to see, can we use this paper-based to make easy-to-use SynBio educational components that could give you tools for low-resource areas or even at-home use. So my favorite gift growing up was a chemistry kit. These all yellow ones. So I did everything in it, and I did things that I shouldn't have been doing that I'm not very proud of, but I did anyway. Could you make the equivalent of that now for synthetic biology and biotechnology? Mom and Dad do not want Junior growing sister's stem cells in the kitchen or the basement. But could you play around with bits of DNA on paper and actually learn how to edit DNA or read and write DNA? And we're now looking how you could do that systematically. And then finally, building again on Mike's other platform, is we're really keen on how you could use this for portable, on-demand molecular manufacturing. So what I didn't share is it's not only limited to paper. So this system will work on any porous media, quartz, plastic, cloth. We've shown you could have wearables. But further, you don't need a substrate. You can freeze dry these as pellets. And so we're now just finishing a study, and you don't have to have it just make reporters. We're now showing you can use this with pellets that can be used to make antimicrobial peptides, that can be used to make antigens, vaccine antigens, nanobodies, phage, viral vectors, multi-component pathways inspired again by Mike's work. So the idea would be, could you have a small kit of freeze-dried pellets for a military personnel, an athlete, a hiker, a healthcare worker, Matt Damon on Mars, where all you need to do is drop this in water to make the molecules that you need in either mix and match fashion, what have you. So with that, I just want to again thank the team and thank this network of young people that I've had the pleasure of working with. And again, I want to thank Milan and Mike and congratulate them and the entire faculty and young students and postdocs here at the center on really just a great celebration and congratulate you all. So thank you.
We have time for a few questions. Time for a few questions. Okay.
Yeah, so it's a great question. I do think the slow speed makes these transcriptional circuits, which has been the dominant, along with now translational circuits in the last 10 years on RNA, but the two, I think they're too slow for much of what we'd like to do. And the metabolic burden has been an area that has really not been addressed, and that is these circuits put a demand on these bugs, and the bugs don't like it, so they spit it out. The field has not gone to where it should in post-translational or protein-protein interactions. I challenged my group going back about 15 years ago, could we do a protein-protein interaction toggle switch? And it wasn't, I didn't know enough to where we could go. Got no takers. And if you look in the literature, there's very little work. Ron Weiss has a paper coming out soon. I don't know which, I think it's in one of the big journals, on a protein-protein toggle switch. So I think for young people, it's a great space to explore because now you have much faster responses. I think the engineering has a whole different set of challenges. There still would be some metabolic demand. You've got to get that protein in there and made. But I do think it's a great space to help launch a PhD, at least.
That's great. Other questions? Yeah.
A lot of interest in expanding to other host bacterium, but one challenge might be that phage typically have a very narrow host range. So what do you think is a good strategy going forward? Is it taking our favorite, the T series, Lambda, M13, and trying to engineer them to infect other bacteria, or to try to pan the environment for new phage that infect, like, say if you're interested, like Listeria or Mycobacterium or something like that, find their native phage and engineer that?
Yeah, it's an interesting question. I'll give a historical anecdote to set that up. So when I got into antibiotics, which is now just 10 years ago, when I would go talk to venture groups, when I talked to pharma, they literally would be pounding on the table and saying, you need to develop broad-spectrum antibiotics. If we're going to put $500 million, $1 billion, it better kill everything. And to think, that's 2006. It's before we really appreciated the microbiome. And it's not that long ago, right? So as I challenge young people, both in synbio, broadly in microbiology, bioengineering, I think the microbiome is one of these great spaces to be in. It's the Wild Wild West for discovery. And at best right now, it's a lot of butterfly collecting. It's the early stage of the field, not yet into mechanism. So to directly address yours, I think as a setup, I think phage are an answer that have been underexplored and should be addressed for narrow spectrum antibacterials. So in fact, while it's a bug, no pun intended, as a negative feature, I actually think it's a positive feature that we should harness. I think having a combination of the two approaches you alluded to are the right way to go. Tim Liu is looking to broaden the host range, and he has little evidence that he can do that. I think the real value is to see how much you can harvest from the outside world. You know, phage, I've heard, are the most abundant source of DNA on the planet. And so why not find them? Now, most will not be easy to engineer because they haven't been studied, but I think as our ability to engineer biology builds, so you can sequence it, can you identify safe harbors in the phage DNA, or could you identify easy ways to manipulate, I think will open up many possibilities, be it for diagnostics or therapeutics, or broadly, environmental remediation via phage.
Well, I'd like to just close and thank Jim once again for just a fantastic lecture. And just before we close here, I'm going to pass the microphone over to my colleague and director of the center, Milan Mrkšić. And just again, as I acknowledged really all of the administration a little bit earlier, I want to acknowledge all of Milan's efforts to really catalyze and move everything forward to help get us here today. So, Milan.
Okay, well, we're going to wrap up here because there's not a lot more to say. I think Jim's lecture perfectly illustrated why we have so much excitement about the field, the center, and moving forward here at Northwestern and with our partners all over. So we're going to stop. There's a reception up in Cohen Commons, the fourth floor of Tech, that you can get to by going up one floor and over the bridge, and there'll be some students pointing the way in case you get lost. So we'll end here and hopefully see you up at the reception. Thanks again to Mike and Jim for two fantastic lectures.